It's a real privilege to be here this evening. Pastor Haggett was reminding me when we met in Piedmont. That was back when I had a full hair, head of hair.
I had one more myself.
Acts 1:8 will be our text for this evening. I'd like to begin reading the Word of God in Acts chapter 1, verse 7. The Word of God says, "And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth." If you'd like to highlight that phrase found in verse 8, "ye shall be witnesses." Let's pray, shall we? Father, help me now, I pray, to communicate this passage, to somehow challenge the people to take this personally, that we are witnesses to this generation. And Lord, may we take that responsibility seriously and take the gospel to the ends of the earth. I pray you would speak to every heart. Be glorified, Lord of all, in Jesus' name. Amen. Ye shall be witnesses. We live in a day and age where we want to pass off responsibility to others. But you know what? The Great Commission has been given to the local church. And as members of the local church, that is placed right directly in our own individual lap. You, yes you, are called of God to be a witness to this adulterous generation. And you have the personal responsibility to take the gospel beginning in Jerusalem. We see here, this is a strategic roadmap for world evangelism. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the world. Jerusalem was the town where they were at. Judea was the region of Jerusalem. Samaria was next door. And the uttermost part is the rest of the globe. Today, we are to take the gospel, beginning in, as we would call it, our own Jerusalem, to our own region, to the regions next door, and to the uttermost part of the world. That may entail you going personally, verbally, with the word, with tracts, perhaps assisting others in going. Paul raised funds to help the church in Jerusalem. He said, "I want this for fruit on your account, that you may abound." And so we see that we can help others take the Great Commission to the rest of the world. Notice it says, "Ye shall receive power." Now, Jesus is speaking to the original disciples. This was before the actual coming of the Holy Spirit that we see in Acts chapter 2. That tongue like a fire that came down on the believers in Acts chapter 2 was, as I believe, none other than the very Shekinah glory of God, signifying that no longer is that visible presence of God on a building like it was in the tabernacle and as it was in that temple in Jerusalem where they were at. Of course, the Spirit had left that temple. Ichabod was written on it. And there was no presence of God for years. And then after Jesus ascended and they were tarrying, the Holy Spirit came down and the tongues like as a fire came upon the heads of the disciples, signifying that it was their body now was the temple of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? If we were conscious of that fact, we would be careful what we consumed, wouldn't we? We would be careful about what we heard and what we see, what entered our eye gates and ear gates. We'd be careful about what we did with our body. The Bible says, whatever we do with this body, it's as if we're doing it with the Lord. May we be fully conscious of the abiding presence of God, the Holy Spirit in our heart. And that presence is the power that we have this evening. Just as power came on the original disciples. Power to preach. The learned scholars marveled that these ignorant men were preaching. That the prison doors were open and they somehow had managed to go back to that temple and preach the word of God as they were commanded not to. The boldness that they had was supernatural. Oh, that God would give us a boldness tonight, today, and this day, this age. We were talking to the other believers in New Franklin, and they were telling us how it's such a hard area here. So many are obviously a Catholic area, and very few solid Bible preaching churches. My home pastor, Dr. Clarence Sexton of the Temple Baptist Church in Powell, Tennessee, which is the home of the Crown College, he laments that the average church has given over to worldliness and is an entertainment-centered ministry instead of a Bible preaching, Christ-honoring assembly like the Bible teaches we're supposed to be. I'm so encouraged to be here tonight, to see you faithful here. I know Pastor Haggett is a man of God preaching the Word of God. And God is looking at us in this room tonight, seeking for a person who will go for me. May we be like Isaiah and say, here I am, send me. Yeah. You might say, well, I'm not trained, I'm not qualified, I don't have the talent. Don't worry about that. God will provide. God will equip. God will give you that which you don't have. Ye shall be witnesses. Do you know what the word ye means? It means you. Put your hand on your chest. Yes, you. You shall be witnesses. Let's try to make this personal, shall we? There's no need for me to just get up here and go through the motions. We need to respond to this. If you shall be witnesses, what are you going to do with that? What is a witness? Well, I looked up that word. Do you know the actual word for witness is martyr? Do you young ladies know what the word martyr means? Well, today when we speak of a martyr, we think of one who gave their life for the gospel, for Jesus' sake. We read in the Middle Ages how people literally gave their life to be burned at the stake rather than deny Jesus. People were put to death over believers' baptism because they refused to give in to infant baptism, which they knew was unscriptural. I wonder if we would give our life for such biblical principles today. Ye shall be witnesses. A witness, what is that? Someone who has seen something or experienced something firsthand. If you saw a car wreck, the police would want you to be a witness. You know, if you went by what somebody else saw, you wouldn't be a witness. Thank you for that testimony, but it's not valid. We need someone who was there. A witness to a murder. Not what somebody told you they saw. Let me ask you a very personal question. Have you witnessed the saving power of Jesus Christ? Has your life been changed by Jesus Christ? I was a child that rode the bus of the Forest Hills Baptist Church in Atlanta, Georgia, when Dr. Curtis Hudson, who later became the editor of the Sword of the Lord, I went to church. I even went forward. I even said the phrase, "Lord, save me." But I did not receive Jesus. I had an empty, powerless prayer without faith. You're saved by grace through faith. The Bible says, "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord," that's understood that you're putting your real faith, that you're actually repenting and receiving. Acts 20, 21, repentance towards God and faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ. For over 10 years, I quit going to church. I was a so-called Christian because I wasn't a Muslim, I wasn't a Jewish, I wasn't a heathen, I wasn't an atheist. I believed in God, but I was without Christ. So I wasn't a real Christian, was I? I never received Christ. I just had a little bit of religion, a little bit of head knowledge. At the age of 21, somebody left, "This Was Your Life" on a Shelley's restaurant. And the Word of God put me under total conviction, having read Matthew 12, 36. And I repented by turning to God, and I received Jesus Christ on May 17th. 1986, and I was born again. 1 Corinthians 5, 7, "The old things were passed away, behold, all things became new." I was a new creature in Christ, and I had the power of God. Before that, I had one of the few things in my life was a vulgar speech. I just cussed like a sailor, unfortunately, and I couldn't even stop cussing for 3 days. I was under total conviction, and I was trying not to cuss, trying to hold it back, but I was powerless. The moment I received Jesus, that vulgar language was gone. I remember that first day. I received the Lord at 11 o'clock at night. The next day, I didn't have to hold it back. I didn't have to suppress. It was gone. I had the power of God to control my tongue. And I knew I had the power of God. Do you know if you are born again, you have all the power that God wants you that you can, if you yield it to God, you would have all that power of God to do great mighty things? What is impossible with God? Absolutely nothing. We need to allow God to use us. Have you submitted yourself to God? Are you a witness to these things? Susan's father has just passed away just 1 week ago. He had suffered with COPD. He couldn't breathe. And it was very sad, very difficult on the family. And we had a funeral, and I've never really liked to have open casket funerals. To me, it's just, but some people feel like they need that. It's something that some people want to be able to see that he's no longer here, to give closure. We witnessed the death of her father. We know that he's no longer on earth. Have you been a witness of Jesus? Is there evidence that God has changed your life? Notice that this power is to go to the uttermost parts of the earth. It says, "You shall be witness to me both in Jerusalem." Jerusalem was where they're at. That was their town. "For you, Marshall, is your Jerusalem," if I may say so. My pastor says, Knoxville is our Jerusalem for our local church that we're members of. Jerusalem, of course, is an actual city in Israel. But we see that it's obviously the most contested spot on earth. the actual historical city of Jerusalem where God gave this commandment. It's where the gospel started. And to this day, it's the bullseye of Satan's hatred and target of the world. We see that for some odd reason, the world hates Jerusalem. Of all the atrocities going on in the world, the United Nations spends more time spending resolutions against the nation of Israel, and it's all in regard to this nation of Jerusalem. They've just passed a UN resolution just before the last president of the United States left office. He refused to veto, which the United States has always had the power to stop a resolution in the United Nations. And for whatever reason, he allowed it to pass that stated that Israel had no right to be in Jerusalem. Now, that's not just talking about East Jerusalem, the so-called half that belongs to the Arabs, as they would say. It actually is all of the old city, which is not just the other side of the Temple Mount. When we see those pictures of the Jewish people up at the so-called Wailing Wall, the Western Wall, that Western Wall of the Temple Mount, where the temple once stood on Mount Moriah. East Jerusalem goes beyond that open synagogue plaza where they gather. It goes beyond the Jewish quarter, the entire Jewish quarter of the old city of Jerusalem is in that so-called occupied area. And if the United Nations had their way, they would force all the Jews to leave their historical place where all of this began. We see that Jerusalem is not only a historical place, not only is it a current hotbed of political activity, but we see it's going to be the future as well. Very quickly, if I could invite you to turn to Matthew 23, 37. Jesus although he had lived in Galilee, he went to Jerusalem. He presented himself at the Feast of the Dedication. He said, "If any man thirst, let him come unto me." He presented himself to all of Israel. And he wept over Jerusalem. He wept because he realized they were not just, they were rejecting him as their Messiah. Matthew 23, verse 37. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and you would not. Behold, your house is left unto you desolate. Ichabod was over the temple. Now, 70 years after the birth of Christ, approximately, the temple was destroyed by Titus. For over 2,000 years, Jerusalem has been desolate. To this day, they cry. Next year in Jerusalem, even though they're there, they're crying for God to bring a temple. The ultra-Orthodox Jews believe that the temple is actually built by God and is sitting in heaven, ready to come down. Just as Daniel speaks of the heavenly Jerusalem, just as Revelation 21 speaks of that new Jerusalem descending. Orthodox Jews believe that. Some feel like they have to build it. Others say, no, it'll just come down like a UFO, as Jews have said to me when I lived in Israel. Once had a man, he said that the temple is on a UFO in heaven, and that the phylactery prayers that the Jews pray with their black box strapped on their forehead, Jesus said, you make broad your phylacteries that you may be seen of men. They say if every Jew was to pray, that God would send the New Jerusalem. They're looking for the temple to be restored. But it's desolate. I say unto you, verse 39, ye shall not see me henceforth till ye say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Jesus said, I will come again. Where will he return? To Jerusalem. Just as he was taken up, the angel said, why stand ye here gazing into heaven? This same Jesus will come in like manner in the clouds. I believe in the visible, personal return of Jesus Christ. And then he warns in chapter 24, they were looking at all the buildings of the temple, and they said, tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? Jesus said in verse 4, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. I have a picture here of a rabbi, Menachem Mendel Schneerson. He died 20 years ago. He's the leader of a group of ultra-Orthodox Jews called the Chabad Lubavitch. Every major city in the world has a Chabad house that these particular ultra-Orthodox Jews have at least two rabbis in a house so all Jews can gather and learn about Judaism. When he died, a Jewish reporter said, what happened to your Messiah? They replied, we as Jews have always believed in resurrection. Why not a resurrected Messiah? We have perfect faith that our rabbi, Menachem Schneerson, will be resurrected from the dead. And he will enter in Jerusalem, lowly riding the colt of an ass, just as it's prophesied in Zechariah 9:9. And he will sit on the throne of his father David and rule from Jerusalem. Many will come in my name, claim to be Christ. He went on to say, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Verse 12. But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then shall the end come. Folks, God is waiting for the gospel to go out into all the world. Jesus is waiting to return. And when we finish God's mission of taking the gospel around the world, then the end will come. And it'll be in Jerusalem. So much more can be said about Jerusalem. He said, both in Jerusalem and in Judea. Judea is that region where the Jews lived. Hebron, where the patriarchs were buried. Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, they're all there in Hebron in the center of that region. That's actually from Jerusalem to the south. When you look on a modern map of Israel and they have the so-called West Bank, it looks like a backwards B. You have the Jordan River and then you have an area above Jerusalem and an area below Jerusalem. And they have a corridor to allow the Jews to come in. And we see that south of Jerusalem is Judea. This is where all the Jews live. It's their historical homeland. Today, it's occupied by the Palestinians. Jews are trying to establish settlements there, and they're told it's illegal. Just recently, we're talking last week, the Israeli government forced Jews out of the so-called West Bank, destroying the settlement of Arona. The world is going to come against Israel because they're living in this land. Judea is the land of the Jews. I think if we were to try to apply that to us, if Marshall, Missouri is your Jerusalem, our Jerusalem, then Missouri would be our Judea, I guess, in that sense. So what is Samaria? From Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria. Samaria was where the Samaritans lived, and they were the foreigners. Those were the half-breeds. You know, we have people that we identify with, that we relate to, and then we have others that are outsiders, so to speak. And we have our own outsiders, don't we? I was in Chicago, Illinois, and a pastor said, we went into one community, it was totally Muslim. They literally said, we're not allowed to go in there. We went in anyway, and the so-called leader of this community put a note on the door of the church. If you come into our Muslim community and try to evangelize again, we'll burn this church building down. That's inside the United States of America. You'll always have Samaritans, people you don't identify with, but guess what? They need to get saved too. It's easy going to Judea and preaching to your fellow men, but we have to go to Samaria. You know, when Jesus went to Samaria, John chapter 6, they thought it was odd. Jews have no dealings with Samaria. Jesus was on a mission. He had to win that Samaritan woman to the Lord. It was at Jacob's Well, which is modern day Nablus. When I was flying to Israel in November, there was a Palestinian looking man next to me. I said, where are you from? He said, I'm a Palestinian from Nablus. And the Holy Spirit of God said, preach to him the Samaritan woman. And I showed him the word of God, and I read to him the story of the Samaritan woman at Jacob's Well. I said, this is your own hometown, and how she came to know Jesus is the Messiah. And I spent an hour witnessing to that Muslim from Nablus, Samaria, and he clicked. I saw that light going in his head. He said, Jesus is the Messiah. And he wanted an Arabic New Testament so that he could study the truth about who Jesus is. So we need to go to the Samaritans. And then to the uttermost. But you know what? It all comes back to Jerusalem. Let's conclude by looking at Zechariah chapter 12, shall we? I mentioned Zechariah 9:9, which talks about the Messiah entering in Jerusalem, riding on the colt of an ass. No doubt that'll be Jesus. Matthew 12 talks about Jerusalem, a cup of trembling. When we see how this world's going to end, it's all going to end focused on Jerusalem. Behold, Zechariah 12:2, I will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling unto all the people round about when they shall be in the siege, both against Judea and against Jerusalem. And in that day I will make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people. Jerusalem is the focus of God, of the devil's wrath. But we see that God's going to use it for good. Look at verse 10. And I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplications, and they shall look upon me whom they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn." Oh, to think of that moment when the Jews realized that they crucified their own Messiah. Jews have to deal with the issue, who is Jesus? Larry King, the well-known Jewish interviewer on TV, he said, "If I die and stand before God, the first question I'm going to ask him is Jesus the Messiah?" Because every time he would interview a religious figure, whether it was Benny Hinn or Joel Osteen or Franklin Graham, the first question he'd say is, "Do Jews have to believe in Jesus?" The Jews cannot escape the main question, who is Jesus? Look at verse chapter 14, verse 2. "I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle and to the city to be taken." We read about the armies of the north and the armies of the east gathering in the plains of Megiddo. We call it the Battle of Armageddon. Samaria is the region from Jerusalem up to the Galilee. Right in the middle of Samaria is this perfect flat plain that Napoleon Bonaparte said was the most perfect battlefield. In the Hebrew tongue, it's called Armageddon, the mountain of Megiddo. And in that day, which may be sooner than we think, some 1 million soldiers will gather. This UN resolution that was just passed may be the very beginning of the actual end of the world. Our new president wants to move the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. Already, Muslim nations said, "Don't do that. It'll start a major conflict." I can see how very easily these modern events can escalate into what we read about. For centuries, we've wondered, how is this battle going to come together? Look at Zechariah 14:4. "And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem in the east. And the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof, towards the east and towards the west." We talk about the personal return of Jesus Christ. Now, there's a lot of stuff here that's hard to understand, obviously. But we understand it enough to believe it by faith. Amen. Jesus is coming again. We see that cup beginning to tremble already. These prophecies are as certain as the past. We see here, verse 16, "And it shall come to pass that everyone that is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem shall even go up from year to year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to keep the Feast of Tabernacles." And in the very end, we're all going to gather and worship Jesus in Jerusalem. Amen. The Bible says that the gospel is to go forth beginning at Jerusalem. It's to go to the uttermost. And it's interesting, when we read the book of Acts, Paul wanted to go east, but God had the angel tell Paul to go west. The gospel went west from Macedonia to Europe. It went to America. We read of revival in South Korea. The gospel is going around the world. And it's going to consummate in Jerusalem.
Let's conclude by Revelation 21. Thank you for allowing me to go through all these scriptures with you. I pray that this is challenging you. There's a direct connection between what we're doing tonight and the consummation of the world. If God's going to bring everything to pass when the gospel's been fully preached, then we need to be a part of that. We literally are a link in the chain that brings the consummation of the world. To think that we can lead the last person to Jesus and then the end come. Wouldn't that be wonderful? And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men." Who is that? It's Jesus. He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people, and God Himself shall be with them and be their God. There's a lot of talk about building walls and having fences. People are offended at that. We see that even heaven itself has a wall. Look at verse 15. "And he that talked with me had a golden reed to measure the city, and the gates thereof, and the wall thereof." We see here, verse 25, "And the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day, for there shall be no night there." You don't have to worry about it. That wall of jasper, God's going to keep all the bad people out. It says that, "For without are the dogs," and the verse 27, "there shall in no wise enter into anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they that are written in the Lamb's book of life." You know what? If you have not been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, and if your name has not been written in the book of life, you're not going to go inside that heavenly city. We see here in verse 17 of Revelation 22, "And the Spirit and the bride say, Come. And let him that heareth say, Come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely." Before we have the word come, God gives us the word go. God has said to us, go. Go ye into all the world. May we take these words personally. When we say, "Lord, I want to be part of your program. I want to be part of bringing in that last remnant before the end of the world." Things are moving very fast. And often we tend to think that the earth will always remain. But these things, Jesus said, "Behold, I come quickly." Wouldn't it be a shame if we look back and say, "I wish I'd have given him more"? Why don't we just determine right now, "I'm going to do all I can for God"? Life is short, death is sure. But only what is done for Christ will last. Let's all bow our heads. And I feel wholly inadequate to try to bring this type of a message. How on earth can I bring the urgency of the moment But may the Spirit of God speak to our hearts and impress upon us that we must be about the Father's business. Ye shall be witnesses. Father in heaven, may we take this personally and say, here I am, Lord. Send me before it's eternally too late. May I do your will and have a part in fulfilling the kingdom of God. For your sake, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother Hagin.